Praise the Lord, and welcome to our morning services here at Covenant Community Church, where people discover and live their God-given purpose. We invite you into the call to worship. God, let this be a fruitful day. In this hour of worship, open our eyes to beauty. Tune our ears to harmony. The fragrance of your love permeating every moment, the touch of your hand guiding all we do. Together we want to taste with delight the joy of your presence here today. Let us pray. Merciful God, we come together to worship longing for tenderness because this world can be hard. We come longing for light because our lives are crowded with shadows. We come desperately needing direction. In this hour of worship, give us provision for the journey, courage and faith and compassion and endurance to face any hardship. Open our eyes to see you walking beside us, protecting us, encouraging us, and loving us. Help us to grasp the full understanding of our obligation to share the gospel, which we have so freely received. May the Holy Spirit lead us in examining ourselves to see if we are ashamed of the gospel and thereby correct and mend our ways. Day by day, give us strength and courage to be your people in this time, in this place. And the people of God said, amen. The scripture reading this morning is taken from Paul's letter to the church at Rome, the book of Romans. The first chapter, verses 14 through 16, and I will be reading from the NIV, the New International Version of the Bible. Hear these words as penned by the early secretaries of the church. I am obligated both to Greeks and non-Greeks, both to the wise and to the foolish. That is why I am so eager to preach the gospel, also to you who are at Rome. I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. May the Lord add a blessing to the hearing and reading and doing of his most holy word. Now we will be ministered in music by Sister Keisha Bollinger, accompanied by our musician, Marlon Webb. Receive them as they now come to minister to us.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are here. You're healing in our land. And we worship you, God. We worship you. You are here. You're turning lives around. And we worship you. Oh, we worship you. So we just say, way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Hey, hey. Way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Oh, oh. Way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Yes, your way maker, miracle worker, a miracle. A miracle worker, miracle worker. That is who you are. Way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. Yes, that is who you are. We say that is who you are. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Keisha and Marlon, for blessing us in the ministry of music. Our sermon topic this morning would be, I am not ashamed of the gospel. Are you? I think the vast majority of us would agree with me that we are living in some of the most difficult and darkest days we have seen in a long time. The days are filled with fears, anxiety, grief, unrest, uncertainties, discord, violence, and hatred. One would be pressed to ask what's happening to our world and what's the answer. I get these questions a lot, particularly in my position as a community leader, serving hundreds of fragile fathers and their families. However, when it comes right down to it, there is really only one thing I, as a pastor, have to offer my congregation, and one thing only that I believe that the church has to offer the world. And that is the gospel of Jesus Christ. A lot of people ask me, what's the answer? I don't know what the answer, but what I do know and what I do believe, the answer to today's problems is the gospel. You see, the gospel creates us, the gospel defines us, and the gospel equips us to serve the world in Jesus' name. Nothing is so precious to us, nothing is so dear to our hearts, nothing can so demand our loyalty and commitment as this gospel. The message of the revelation of Jesus Christ is like a vast fortune that has been entrusted into us. We are accountable before God to invest it into the lives of people. We cannot hide the good news and bury it in the ground. We must put it out in the marketplace of this world. We must deposit it into people who do not know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Oftentimes, sometimes when people ask me about mentoring and will I be a mentor to someone, I'm not so much concerned as mentoring is making disciples and leading others to a saving knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in my last days here on earth. We cannot be hoarders of the truth. And I'm sure some of you have seen the show, The Hoarders, where people just hoard and hold on to things. And I think sometimes when it comes to the gospel, we are hoarders of the truth, the good news. But we must be shrewd investors of this sacred message and see it yields an eternal rate of return throughout the ages to come. Here's what I think about it. When we stand before the Lord on the last day, and yes, we will have to give an account for what we did with the gospel. We will not be asked what our pastor did with the gospel, nor what did the elders or the deacons did with it. Each of us, beloved, individually will have to answer to the Lord for how we invested the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, while this is important, but it is not enough to come to Bible study and take notes. It's not enough to be able to articulate what the gospel is. More importantly than that, the message of the gospel must be proclaimed. And therefore, to help us with this, in this lesson, we want to look at Romans chapter 1, as I read, verse 14 and 16. And of course, the thrust of these verses, the quintessential factor, the essence, the linchpin of these three verses is that it is not enough to know the gospel in your mind and heart. You have to speak the gospel with your mouth. And so our first concern is obligated in verses 14. In verses 14 and 16, the apostle begins each verse with strong resolves of I am. These are I am statements. These words reveal Paul's compelling sense of obligation in the proclamation of the gospel. These three I ams reveal his eagerness and his excitement for the spread of the gospel. It is the burning passion of his soul. It is what motivates him and propels him forward. And that which fuels Paul, beloved, must fuel us as well. So let us give a special attention to what the Apostle Paul says here. Paul begins by saying in verse 14, he says again, I am obligated both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the foolish. Notice that he begins, I am, in the present tense. Not I will in the future, someday later, not I once was in the past. The use of the present tense indicates the constant state of his life. Every moment of every day, this is true. Paul writes on his third missionary journey while in Corinth, but no matter where Paul is, whenever it is, he is always under obligation. He says, I am obligated. Now, when Paul says, I am obligated, if you will read the King James or the New King James Version, it says, I am a debtor. That is very much the idea through obligation works as well in this NIV translation. The word, the Greek word, ophiliates, means a person indebted, one who owes another. Its background speaks of a financial obligation that is owed by one person to another. If you are a debtor to someone, you have an obligation to pay off the debt that is owed. And this should strike us as surprising in that Paul has never been to Rome. He's saying, I am obligated, I am a debtor, but it is interesting to note that Paul has never been to Rome. And so why would he be indebted to people he has not even met or borrowed anything from? He's never met these believers, yet he claims to be in debt with people he has never been to see. Ah, this is important. Somebody need to catch this. Then how does this work? You can be in debt two ways. One way is as if someone lends you $100. As long as that $100 is in your pocket, you are a debtor to the lender. You need to give it back to him at some point. The other way would be if someone gave you $100 bills and said, when you see a certain person, give him or give her a $100 bill. The result is a two-way debt. As long as this $100 is in your pocket, you are not only in debt to the lender, but to the person to whom you are to give it to. And the second way is the manner which Paul means he has incurred this debt. This, if you will also like to go and study in the parable of the unmerciful servant in the Gospel of Matthew 18, where the unforgiven servant was forgiven of his debt, then when he saw somebody later down the road who asked him to forgive him, and he did not want to forgive him, even though he had been forgiven. So Paul is talking about this here. He understood. Here's what he's saying. Paul understood the vast riches of the gospel had been deposited into his account the moment he became a believer. See, something happened to you and I as soon as we become a believer in Jesus Christ. A deposit, an earnest, a seal, a deposit is made into us. He was made the recipient of a free gift, the free gift of salvation. But he was charged by God to give it to others. Catch this. He was charged by God to give it to others what had been deposited into him. I'm trying to talk to somebody this morning. I remember as a kid growing up and going to church with my father, and a hymn that he would always line and sing with the stewards and the trustees of the church was that old Methodist hymn from Charles Wesley, "A Charge to Keep I Have, a God to Glorify, and Fit It for the Sky." That was my father's favorite hymn because he knew he had a charge to share the gospel. And Paul, he must tell people about Jesus Christ and the way of salvation in order to remove his obligation to God and those without the gospel. And beloved, the message is one of the same is true for us. As long as I withhold the gospel from someone else, whether it is in my office, in my family, in my neighborhood, or at school, or someone I sit near on a plane, I remain in debt to them because God has entrusted to me the truth to give to them. This is Steve. You don't hear this again. As long as I withhold the gospel from someone else, whether it's in my neighborhood or in my fraternity, sorority, my office, my family, school, I remain in debt to them. This is what Paul is talking about. Because God has entrusted to me, to you, the truth to give to them. He said, I gave it to you to give to them. And on the last day, you and I are going to have to give an account to God. And it will be revealed whether we invested the gospel into the lives of others or if we hoarded the truth and kept it to ourselves. But then Paul goes on a little further. Not only he says he's obligated, but he goes on a little further in verse 14. He says, both to Greeks and to barbarians, both to the wise and to the foolish. When Paul says he's obligated to the Greeks, he refers to his indebtedness to those who are at the top of society's ladder. They were the cultured and educated of the ancient society. The Greeks were refined and polished. They loved literature and the arts. They had been trained in social graces and manners. But Paul also writes that he's also obligated to the barbarians. The barbarians were the total antithesis of the Greeks. If the Greeks were at the top of the social ladder, the barbarians were in the basement. You could not be any more base than they were. The barbarians were crude and rude, lacking in any social graces and cultural polish. They had no learning and could not even read. To the Greek mind, when the barbarians spoke, their pronunciations of word was so rough that they abused the language. They could hardly be understood in what they were saying. When they spoke, it sounded as if they were saying, ba, 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 ba. Barbarian is not even a word, but a marking of people who have never been taught how to read, write, or speak with eloquence. But Paul must also reach them with the gospel. And when Paul says, I am under obligation to both the Greeks and the barbarians, he means not only to those at the top rung of the letter or the bottom rung of the letter, but to every other rung on the letter. In other words, he's obligated to everyone. You would say it in the present day, from the East Coast to the West Coast and everybody in between, in the Midwest and everywhere in between. That if a person is breathing, if they're walking on 2 feet or in a wheelchair, whatever, he is indebted to talk to them about Jesus Christ as God has given him the opportunity. Paul then says, both to the wise and to the foolish. I wouldn't have time to go into that, but it's another way of saying the same thing. Then the next verse, verse 15, Paul says, that is why I am eager to preach the gospel or evangelize, to preach the gospel also to you who are at Rome. Catch that, this is very important. In other words, he is saying no matter what anybody does, for my part, he is eager to preach the gospel. Eager, prothumos, the Greek word. It's a compound word that pictures the forward lean of a runner. Pressing forward with the gospel. The main root word for eager, thumos, is the same word for passion. It literally means heavy breathing. The word gives the picture of a horse that is breathing heavy, ready to charge ahead in the day of battle. Paul is eager to take the gospel to others. Every one of us needs to be able to say, for my part, I am eager. You see, it is one thing to have an obligation to pay a debt, but it is something else to be eager to pay off the debt. Anyone can be under obligation, but then drag their feet to discharge their duty. Just like Paul, we must have the heart motive that is a privilege to tell others about Christ. It is even a joy. It is fulfilling the very purpose of why we're here on planet Earth. Now, notice something, my beloved. However, for the apostle, his strongest passion, this is very important, is to reach Rome with the gospel. And you say, well, what's the big deal about that, to reach Rome? Well, this is an amazing statement, because the toughest place in the known world to preach the gospel would have been Rome. This is the capital of the Roman Empire, where flagrant depravity was prevalent everywhere. Rome was a cesspool of iniquity, as the most idolatrous, immoral, and sensuous place in the known world. Yet, despite how dark it is, Paul declares that he is eager to go to Rome, the toughest place to share the gospel. As one scholar said, he knows that the darkness cannot expel the light, but the light will always expel the darkness. Therefore, Paul is ready and eager to go to Rome. Paul's own conversion is a prime example of one who was the hardest to reach with the gospel. No one was further away from Jesus Christ than Saul of Tarsus. Paul understood that if he could be brought to faith in Christ, then anybody can. If the Lord can capture him, the Lord can capture anybody. If he, the chief of sinners, can be saved, then any other sinner can be won to Christ. He was one who would be labeled as hardest to reach with the gospel. Yet he was the one who the Lord saved. What about you? Were you hardest to reach? Or maybe somebody listening this morning and you have not been reaching, you think of yourself as one that is hardest to reach? This begs the question then, my beloved, and I want you to think about this and I ponder about this. What is your Rome? And Homer, I'm not talking about Rome, Georgia, or Rome you're going to in Europe. What is your hardest place to witness? Is it with your closest friends? Is it with people with whom you work? Is it with family members? Who are those people that you have almost written off as those who are impossible to reach with the gospel? We have to be eager to reach those who are the farthest away from the Lord. Paul is eager to go to the most difficult place, Rome. We must be ready and eager to go to the hardest place to reach the hardest people with the gospel. There's one more I am statement that Paul makes here. After he says, I am obligated and I am eager, he then says, I am not ashamed. Paul says, I am not ashamed of the gospel because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes. This is my favorite part of this nutshell, because it is not saying that the gospel brings the power of God, or it results in the power of God, or it means to the power of God, but rather it says the gospel is the power of God. Therefore, when I believe it, when I hear it, when I understand it, and when I grasp its propositions, its meaning, its words, to the degree that I actually get this gospel into my life, the power of the gospel is coursing through me. It is the power of God. And therefore, the way you know you're beginning to understand the gospel, here's the way that you know you're beginning to understand the gospel and there's a breaking through, is instead of it just being a set of ideas, instead of just some religion, you begin to sense it being a power. And that's why Paul says in his letter to Timothy, you have a form of godliness, a form of religion, but thereby denying the power thereof. A lot of people have the outer trappings of religion, but no power. And that's why oftentimes in life, Christians are more victims than victor. And Paul says, I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. And you have that power. Notice connected to this idea of the power of God, he says, I am not ashamed of the gospel. When you say something like that, I am not ashamed of her. I am not ashamed of him. I am not ashamed of that. That means that there are a whole lot of other people who are, or you wouldn't have said that. Just like in Paul's time, there are a whole lot of other people who are offended, or they think the gospel is crazy. It's either too simple, and sometimes they offended by the gospel because they say it's too simple, and they want people to go through all those hoops and trials and things. You got to do this, you got to do that, you can't live this, you gotta, all these other things. But the gospel is simple, is that those who believe on the Lord Jesus Christ shall be saved. That's the good news. That's the message. But if we, sometimes with a lot of fundamentalists and conservatives want a lot of hoops for you to go through, and say it's too simple, so I'm offended by it. Then there are others who say that it's too easy or too preposterous. In today's world, everyone knows that this thing like Jesus' miracle and resurrection can't happen. This gospel is just not in tune with the sophisticated world in which we live. What does it have to do with network news, CNN, and the New York Times, and our intellectual bastions of universities? The gospel, it doesn't make any sense for some people to say about miracles and resurrections in today. But I tell you what, if you believe in a miracle when you need one. And Paul in his time knew also that it was an offense to the Jews and it was foolishness to the Gentiles. He knew the temptation to be ashamed of this message because other ones was making mockery of it. Nevertheless, he stood flat-footed and boldly declared that he was not ashamed of the gospel. Why is it that he stood flat-footed and said that he's not ashamed of the gospel? Because he said it is the power. It is the power of God for salvation. It is because the gospel has the supernatural power to liberate believers from their bondage to sin. I don't care how long you've been in bondage, whether it's been 5 minutes or 5 years, the gospel can set you free. The gospel can set the captives free. It can make the dumb speak, the blind see, the lame walk. It does not matter how sinful a person is. It does not matter into what deviant lifestyle they have fallen. It does not matter if you are a Greek or a barbarian or wise or foolish. And beloved, I want to say to us today, it doesn't matter whether you are a racist, a game banger, a drug dealer, prostitute, or a user. It doesn't matter whether you're an alcoholic, a fornicator, or a highly esteemed professional. It does not matter who you are or what you are or where you are. The gospel is far more powerful than the power of your sin. The gospel is able to overcome any hardened resistance against God. I know some people who've been hard, and God will soften their hearts. The Holy Spirit will minister to them, and they have fight against God for years, but God still, the word of God is like a hammer, Jeremiah says. The word power, dunamis, comes from the Greek word that comes into the English language as dynamite. The gospel is the explosive dynamite of God unto salvation. No one can receive the gospel, and it does not dramatically impact their lives. When you believe the gospel, you will be radically transformed at the deepest level of your being. The gospel is not just painting the exterior of your life. This is a total reconstruction process. The old practices of sin are torn down. New things are put in its place. You are totally rewired and restructured. You have a new mind, a new heart, a new attitude, and a new will. You have a new disposition. You have a new standing before God. You have a new priority, a new pursuit, new life direction, and new destiny. And that's why like Paul, I am not ashamed of the gospel. Are you? I am reminded of the story of a girl who was deeply ashamed of her mother. The mother's hands were grotesquely scarred from burns. And the girl insisted that her mother always wear gloves to cover up their ugliness. Then one day the girl asked her mother how her hands had become so badly scarred. "I burned my hands when you were only a baby," she said. "When I reached out to pull you out of a fire." From that day, nothing gave that girl more pride than her mother's mangled hands. They became to her the most beautiful hands in all the world. Are you embarrassed by the old-fashioned gospel message that seems so easy, simple, or preposterous? Are you ashamed of the one who endured the humiliation of being spat upon, mocked, beaten, and then nailed to the cross? Are you ashamed of a Savior who shed his own blood for sinners like you and me? You shouldn't be. But there's only one thing worse than you being ashamed of him. And that is him being ashamed of you. We must never be ashamed of the gospel. Beloved, Paul says adamantly, "I am not ashamed of the gospel." But as a precursor before that, there are three I am statements that I want you to meditate and ponder over and ask yourself as you reflect on this message. Paul says from the beginning in verse 14, he says, I am obligated. And another translation say, I am under obligation. And another translation say, I am a debtor. But he is saying, I am obligated. I have a responsibility. And we shared with you what it means to be a debtor and to owe to somebody else, even people you have not met or known, and that I am a debtor, to pay a debt because God put something in me. And I don't know about you, God did something for me. He took my feet out of the muck and the mire and the clay. He set my feet on the solid rock. He changed my stammering tongue and gave me a new hope in life. Are you a debtor? Do you understand you're obligated? The second thing he says, not only am I obligated, I am eager. And he says, let me go back again. He says, I'm obligated to both Greek and barbarians, to the wise and to the foolish. And then he says, I am eager to preach the gospel, to evangelize, to share the gospel, no matter where I am, even to those in Rome, to the most difficult place. What are those difficult places? Who have you given up on? But be very careful before you say who you're giving up on, because somebody didn't give up on you. Somebody prayed for your salvation. I'm obligated. I am eager. And more importantly, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. Why? Because it's the power of God unto salvation. Amen. And now I invite you to reflect on God's word as Sister Keisha Bollinger comes again, accompanied by our musician Marlon, to bless us in the ministry of music.
Light into my body.
Thank you, Keisha and Marlon, for blessing us in the ministry of music. Now you at home have an opportunity to participate in the act of giving and thanksgiving. The first words of the Bible are about God's generosity. God gave us the gifts of a beautiful creation, our home, the good green earth, and the animals that live here with us. On this beautiful summer morning, we come together virtually to thank God and to offer our gifts so that the ministry of this church will continue to grow and be a blessing to the world. Let us gather our gifts together and offer them to God in gratitude and praise. You are invited to give online through our secured Tithely app by mail or dropping your offering in our drop box outside of the church. Please remember, just because we are not meeting in person, to neglect your gifts for the building of God's kingdom. And if you're not a member of this church, if you would like to seed into our ministry, we welcome that as well. With your gifts in hand, let us pray. Good and faithful God, we bring our tithes and offerings to you this morning as part of our act of praise. The psalmist reminds us that you have filled our cup to overflowing, and we are convicted by the image that perhaps we have only offered to you what spills out of our cup. In your grace and love, let us see it instead that your love and blessing will not be contained in any vessel, but will always overflow to reach and bless others. May we not only see it this way, may we live it in lives of generosity. In the name of Christ, who gave all and held nothing back, the people of God said, amen. And now, as we prepare to close, as always, a reminder, if you are interested in growing in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we invite you to our men's and women's Bible studies that are held on Saturdays at 8:30 a.m. and 10:15 a.m. respectively. For more information, if you're interested in joining us, more information is available in our Friday newsletter. And also, if you have been blessed by today's message, please share this message with someone you know. And again, as a friendly reminder, that our targeted opening date is Sunday, August the 2nd. Let us pray and the benediction. Our Father, we thank you for the gospel. We thank you that we are able to look at what St. Paul has said that has changed so many lives. It's changed mine and so many in our listening audience. We ask that you would help us not to be ashamed of the gospel and live in such a way that we know that we are loved by you and sense your calling into a whole new life. And now, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. And the people of God said, amen.